Just so that people can, if you want to sit down.
Oh, that's fine. Okay. Hi, everybody. Can you hear me all over there? Okay. Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here. Usually, the best way to clear a cafe, other than shouting fire, is to say that you're going to talk about physics. So I'm very, very pleased to see you're not deterred by the title. And even in the world of physics, perhaps the most bizarre part is quantum mechanics. And right away, let me answer the question posed in my talk, which says, does anybody get it? The answer is no. So we don't get it. None of the people really understand at any instinctive level what happens in the world of quantum mechanics. So that's a good thing for you guys, because you're not expected to follow this either. So you can just relax and enjoy your drink. You will achieve our stated objectives, which is that we all leave the room. See, in the beginning, only I don't understand quantum mechanics. But after this hour, you too will not understand quantum mechanics. So I'm spreading the ignorance around. So that's why I'm here. That's my mission. All right. Now, I'm a practicing physicist, and I give talks quite often. But perhaps the most difficult ones are the ones like this, because my hands are tied. I'm told that I cannot use any equations. And that is the language in which we do our physics. But if I'm not allowed to use the equations, I'm at a real disadvantage. In fact, when I talked to Yale alumni, they calculated that every equation I use cost the development office about $2.6 million. So the crowd becomes very hostile the minute you turn technical. But that's mostly what we do in physics. It's a lot of mathematics. And we have to find a way around that, and it's not easy. Because you've got to imagine the opposite situation. Suppose you are an English professor and you want to talk about what's so interesting about Romeo and Juliet to a group of people who have absolutely no concept of romance or love, say a group of physicists. Just imagine. And you've got to tell these nerds what is nice about Romeo and Juliet. So you start saying, well, these two people are in love. And the physicist says, look, use that word love. I'm not familiar with that. So could you somehow avoid using such technical terms and tell me what's in the plot? Then you say, well, they feel an attraction for each other. Oh, I know what you mean. So you say attraction proportional to the product of the two masses. And he said, no, it's not how big the masses are, but how they are shaped that seems to be more important. So you're not able to make any contact with people who don't have the background. But turns out there is one escape route, which I'm going to follow, which is that physics is the description of the natural world, and a lot of it is technical. That must be something one should be able to tell the taxpayer about what's going on in the world of physics. And there are a few things. Even in subjects like relativity, there are surprising things. Things you can state with no language barrier, where what I say, the way it sounds to me is the way it sounds to you. Because sometimes in physics you use words like force and work, they all mean very different things. But there are other things which are the same for all of us. So for example, in Einstein's theory, there's a very surprising result, which is the following. So you take two people, and let's say they are twins, and one of them, let's say they're 10 years old when the story begins, and one of them can go in a rocket and travel at some pretty high speed, comparable to the speed of light, and come back. And when the other twin is 60 years old, the person who came back can be 50 years old, 40 years old, 30 years old, as little as you want. You cannot go backwards in time, but you can pretty much freeze time just by going at high speeds. Now, that's very surprising, but it's true. It's not science fiction, and it sounds like what it really is. You can actually do this. Now, you don't do this with real people because we don't have a way to send real people at such comparable speeds. But in these particle accelerators, there's all these particles going around, like the one in Geneva now. They're going at almost the speed of light. And for that reason, they all live much longer than they should. So particles are expected to live a very short time. But when you start them moving, the clock slows down. And they live very long. So that's an example of phenomenon which can be explained to people. The mathematics behind it is different. But the actual physical fact that you can take two people of the same age and then have one go on a huge journey and come back, not aging at all. That's the true thing. Okay. Similarly, in quantum mechanics, there are some things that happen which are bizarre. So I'm going to tell you just about one of those things. Now, first rule in any physics classroom is that the professor has heard it many, many times, can barely stay awake. So the, what makes it interesting is what the people in the class do. And that, in this occasion, would be you guys. Okay? You can stop me anytime, and you can stop me whenever I say something you don't understand. Because there is no way we are going to get through all the topics in quantum mechanics, right? Quantum mechanics, quantum field theory, string theory, can go on talking for 10 years. So we're not going to finish the syllabus. So whatever we talk about, let's make sure we all understand. Okay. So let's be very clear. I do not mind if you ask questions. Now, other worry people have, these are very bright kids at Yale, they're always worried that there's something wrong with them because they have these questions and maybe no one else is asking. It's generally not true. Usually in a classroom, when you have a problem and you ask a question, most people are very grateful that you did, because what was bothering you was also bothering other people. So feel free, okay? And especially since you are off the hook, you're not responsible for this material in any way, you don't have to feel bad. If I went to a conference in psychology, I'll have my hand up all the time because they don't know me and I can make a fool of myself. That's why we're all here. So don't worry about it. So what is the one phenomenon in quantum mechanics that is strange? First of all, I got to tell you the context of quantum mechanics. Before you do quantum mechanics, what was there before? Well, there was Newtonian mechanics. And Newtonian mechanics is a very well laid out scheme that you can use to describe just about anything you see in this room. All the macroscopic physics, you, me, ping pong balls, footballs, rockets, planets, all described by Newtonian mechanics. And the way you play the game in Newtonian mechanics is the following. I will tell you a few things about the world right now, then you will predict for me what will happen in the future. So what you tell me right now is called the initial data. You've got to tell me something about now, using which I'll predict what will happen later. So here's a simple example. So there is a sun, and there's a planet. And we just want to know, we assume the sun is not moving, we just want to know what the planet will do. So first I have to tell you the location of the planet. Then I have to tell you also how fast it's moving. When I say fast, technically I have to tell you how fast and in what direction. That's called the velocity. I might say the velocity is 60 feet per second in this direction. Suppose there was no sun. Can you predict, you know, where the planet will be 1 second later? Anybody have an idea of what the answer to that is? So you seem to know. That's correct. Let me repeat what he said. 60 feet in the same direction is where it'll be after 1 second, and 120 feet after 2 seconds. So it's very easy to make predictions for an object that's not being pulled or pushed by anything else. It just keep going at the same speed. But if you have a sun here, we all know what's going to happen. It's not going to keep doing this. It's going to start bending in an orbit around the sun. That's because the sun is pulling it in. And the force of the sun will change the velocity from pointing that way to pointing in another direction, and also maybe speeding up and slowing down and changing directions. The way we do the physics is, I ask you first, where is it and how fast is it moving right now? Then 1 millionth of a second later, knowing the velocity, I can tell you where it'll be. And knowing the acceleration due to the sun, I'll tell you what the new velocity will be. Then I go to the new location and repeat this calculation. So you inch yourself instant by instant and you calculate, and if you do that, you'll find it's going around the sun in a nice elliptical orbit. This is what Newton did. So this is the standard problem in Newtonian mechanics. Give the initial conditions, tell me who are all the players, and predict the future. In fact, according to classical mechanics, classical meaning before the last century, before Einstein and Planck and all those people, there is nothing left to chance. The entire fate of the universe is completely determined. Why?